Then little children were brought to Jesus, that he might put his hands on them and pray. But the disciples rebuked them. Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me. Do not forbid them, for of such is the kingdom of heaven." And he laid his hands on them and departed from there. My name's Arthur. Thank you for joining me as we share together these words from Matthew chapter 19, verses 13 to 15. Jesus places great importance on little children. These are children who are not going to debate with him or argue with him. They were brought by their parents to Jesus that Jesus might simply pray for them and bless them. And when they grew up, they would remember that day that they were brought to Jesus. Jesus has much to say about children. Back in chapter 18, he used children as a model for how believers should behave. Indeed, believers are called little children by John. We are sons of God, but in our relationship with God, we are but children. We know very little. Nevertheless, just as a child has a permanent bond with his parents, even though he is very young, so the believer in Christ has a secure relationship with God through Christ, even though we do not understand very much about the nature of God. Back in chapter 18, he was challenging the disciples to become like little children. He says, "Whoever humbles himself as this little child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven." The child that is brought to Jesus is seeking to learn. He's inquisitive, but he is humble. He's not boasting that he already knows enough and he doesn't want to learn anymore. But we as adults are often resistant to learning new things. And then he said, "Whoever receives one little child like this in my name receives me." And so he'd already taught them that they should be welcoming to little children, not turning them away. But the disciples were saying, "Oh, Jesus is too important to be bothered with children." No, children are too important to be set aside. And then in verse 6 he said, "Whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and he were drowned in the depth of the sea." So there is a grave warning for those who turn young children away from faith in God. That's no doubt why we are horrified when we see images of children bearing weapons. Even at an age where they're struggling to lift a rifle, it is put in their hands and they are told this is the way of life. No, Jesus wants the little children to come to him. And so woe to those who would turn children away and cause them to stumble in relation to God. And then again in chapter 18 verse 10 he says, "Take heed that you do not despise one of these little ones. For I say to you that in heaven their angels always see the face of my Father who is in heaven. For the Son of Man has come to save that which was lost." Sometimes we wonder what happens when a child dies. Will they be in heaven? I conclude from these verses that yes, they will be received by the Father. They will not be turned aside because their angels are always representing them to the Father. And of such is the kingdom of heaven. All those babies that are aborted, those children that are sacrificed to the indulgence of their parents, they will be received. We have a couple of stories in the Old Testament that support that. When David committed adultery with Bathsheba, the child that was conceived subsequently died. David was distraught as he anticipated the death of this child. But when the child died, he was able to say, "He will not come back to me, but I will go to him." He knew that that child was received of God. And then there was that wicked king Jeroboam. In 1 Kings chapter 14, when Abijah the son of Jeroboam became sick, Jeroboam sent his wife to the prophet to ask about the child. The prophet's response was that Jeroboam and all his household would be killed in judgment for his wickedness. But this child, Abijah, all Israel shall mourn for him and bury him, for he is the only one of Jeroboam who shall come to the grave, because in him there is found something good towards the Lord God of Israel in the house of Jeroboam. Coming back to Matthew, we find when Jesus comes into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday that there's great celebration in the crowd, and that celebration is led by the children. Verse 15 of chapter 21. When the chief priests and scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children crying out in the temple, saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David," they were indignant. And they said to him, "Do you hear what these are saying?" And Jesus said to them, "Yes, have you never read, 'Out of the mouth of babes and nursing infants, you have perfected praise'?" So children are able to praise God in innocence and in truth. It never ceases to amaze me, the enthusiasm young children have, and it saddens me when they turn away as they get older. But I've sought to teach children that they might come to him and that I might not turn them away from him. A strong observation that has been made from those who've looked at congregations is that the majority of people who continue in church come to the Lord while they are young, before they're 12 years old. Some older people turn back to the Lord, having been distracted from him, for the principle that Solomon taught was to teach a little child the way she should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. So teaching children is fundamental, and I suspect this is why there is pressure to get scripture out of schools, so that children do not hear the name of Jesus and never understand what Jesus is about. We are all accountable to him. In the end, we will all stand before him, either to be rewarded or to be condemned, according as to whether we have rejected Jesus or received him. And so our verses today, little children were brought to him that he might put his hands on them and pray, but the disciples rebuked them. Our dealing with little children needs to be personal. He put his hands on them, and furthermore, praying for them. Let's not just teach them, but pray that the Spirit of God will give them understanding. In a society where grown-ups tend to push aside children, Jesus says, "Let the little children come to me. Do not forbid them, for of such is the kingdom of heaven." Jesus is commending those who brought the children to him, and he's telling his disciples not to turn them away. He laid his hands on them and departed from there. Teaching children is, first of all, the responsibility of parents. In the Old Testament, the fathers were to tell the stories of Scripture to their children, telling them what God had done for the children of Israel. And so it is the responsibility, according to the New Testament, that fathers should train their children. So we read in Ephesians chapter 6, "And you fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath, but bring them up in the training and admonition of the Lord." So the emphasis here is the children are to obey their parents, but spiritual training is the responsibility particularly of the fathers. If the father neglects this responsibility, even if the mother follows God, the children are faced with a conflict. But if the father and mother follow after the Lord, then the children are presented with a model. And the fathers are to bring up their children in the training and admonition of the Lord. The comment that the Lord made to Abraham was that, "I have known him. I have known him in order that he may command his children and his household after him, that they keep the way of the Lord, to do righteousness and justice, that the Lord may bring to Abraham what he has spoken to him." So it is our responsibility to train our children. It is our responsibility to introduce our children to the way of the Lord and to our Lord Jesus Christ. "Let the little children come to me. Do not forbid them, for of such is the kingdom of heaven.